episode of the year before. It's a show where we watch three movies at a time each year, going back in time, learning film history, and having fun while we do it. Fun is booze.
This is true.
Yeah, so this is kind of like a student work show, basically. Because we're not really experts or anything. I mean, we like movies. Obviously, we love movies. I've seen a lot in my time. But this is sort of like a way for us to get closer to film. Because not only are we learning from it by watching it, but we get to taste a little bit of that behind-the-scenes stuff while we're making this. So we're going to do all the amateur things while we go along. Like, for one thing, we're going to have blurry footage at some point that we have to use and make really, like, pretentious black-and-white photos of ourselves and all that kind of stuff. Let's talk about the first movie that we watched today.
All right, Ethan, I think it was your pick first.
So the first movie we watched today was my movie. It was my pick. It was a 2005 film called Bubble, which actually ended up on a Best of the Year for Roger Ebert for 2006 because of release reasons. The movie is made by Steven Soderbergh, who's been making movies for a really long time. He does a little bit of the indie stuff, kind of like this. And he also did the Oceans movies as well, which I actually really like the first one. The other ones are kind of like garbage. Oh, we should say right off the bat, because as soon as we're going to show these clips, it's going to be like, oh, what is this movie? All of the actors are non-actors. They are people who Steven Soderbergh, I guess, just discovered in like Ohio or something like that when he was driving around. And famously, this is a trivia fact for the film, Martha, who is the lead in the movie, and does a really great job, actually. She was discovered at a KFC drive-thru. She's like the manager of the KFC or something like that. So who knew that she would be such a charismatic and engaging lead?
I want to get a picture. She's my bestest friend. Mm-hmm. You're my best friend, and I just need to get a picture of you.
So she works at a doll factory with this kid, Kyle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they have like a relationship because they're the only two people that can talk to each other. And if you've ever worked a job like this before, which I have once, you talk to the people that you relate to regardless of any differences that might be in your demographic. Because you're both poor. That's the thing that kind of connects the both of you. We're all poor on this show. We're broke. This is a poverty show. Hence why you can hear the cold wind breezing into the attic right now as we're filming in the dead of winter.
It's about 55 degrees in the studio.
Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah. You know, you kind of get the impression as the film goes on, might be something a little bit more special to Martha than it is for Kyle. And their friendship is sort of put in jeopardy once Rose shows up. That bitch.
You know you gotta double glue those before you put them in a box, right?
Yes, I'm aware of that.
So she kind of throws off the dynamic, and then after a little while, there's a murder plot that kind of evolves, and that's sort of what the back half of the movie is. It's where Rose, spoiler alert.
Watch out for the spoilers. The movie's like 70 minutes long.
It's 73 minutes
long. Watch
out
for the spoilers. You might spoil the last 30 minutes.
So Rose gets murdered.
Yeah, she gets killed.
You don't know why or who did it for a little while. And it sort of forces you to reevaluate how you feel about everybody. And that's the movie.
It is tight. Tight is a good way to describe the movie.
Yeah, very tight.
Which I really appreciate. There's a certain story that they wanted to make with the movie. And they made movie until they told that story. And then stopped making movie. Which seems simple. It seems basic.
This is how every movie should be.
But alas.
And then we get movies like Transformers.
Mojo, off the robot! God.
And yet a lot of the scenes have a lot of time to breathe, too.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you get lots of shots of just the working of the factory.
Mm-hmm.
It never feels like it's too much, but it's super atmospheric.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's not a whole ton of story, and there's not a whole ton of movie to fill, and what space there is almost aggressive realism.
But it doesn't have that kind of Darren Aronofsky sort of like fake realism where it's more sad than real life. It's sad because it's so like real life.
This looks like Ohio, that's for sure.
Most boring state to look at.
Nowhere, comma, anywhere.
Were you depressed? Did this bum you out?
Not entirely. You know what made me glad to be a Michigander? To not live in Ohio?
Let's talk a little bit about the characters.
Yeah, I guess so.
Three characters.
Yeah. Four. We have four characters. No, five. We have five characters.
Are you counting the grandpa?
Six characters. But he doesn't really count. He's like an ornament.
Like, other than the prime three.
He's basically part of the set design.
Are we counting the detective?
Martha,
I'm counting the detective.
Kyle, Rose.
And
oh, yeah.
Detective. Yeah. And shit boyfriend.
Yeah.
Shit boyfriend. Yeah.
Guess what happened in my house?
What? What do you want?
A little bit of money. A bag of herb.
What about Kyle's mom? Ornament?
Yeah. Ornament. Because she occupies the same space that
Grandpa does.
Martha's dad does. Where they're just on the couch. They don't move from the couch.
They're part of the setting.
Yeah. It's like, oh yes, Martha's place. Where Grandpa.
It is natural habitat. So yeah, we mentioned Martha. You think you did a good job with that.
I know we're going to get into the characters in particular, but I do want to say, as a whole, everybody in the movie seems like there's just something about them where I really did enjoy everyone's presence on screen.
I think it's because they act like real humans.
We just came off of Transformers, so we're looking at this like, oh, finally. But yeah, it just feels so nice.
Kyle is her coworker. Mm-hmm. They have lunch together. She gives him rides to his other job at the shovel factory.
I forgot that the movie does close with the greatest outro ever of Kyle testing out the shovels at the shovel factory. Yeah. He's the quality control guy. That's his job, is to test the shovels to make sure that they're working appropriately. Like,
yep, shoving.
This is a shovel. Next one.
Which is just as exciting as I've made it sound.
But he's got a good friend in Martha.
Yeah. And he didn't finish high school.
That's
which
right.
We learned in a conversation between him and Rosa, and I didn't finish high school.
No, actually, I had anxiety, and I ended up quitting.
What is that?
Just around when I got around a lot of people, you know, I just get a little bit nervous, and sometimes I have a panic attack.
Rose enters the scene earlier when she's hired in the doll factory.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we get some very Birdemic-esque scenes in the doll factory where Birdemic is a great movie that everyone should see. But
go see Birdemic today.
Congratulations!
The point I'm making is like when we're looking at Rose being introduced, it's very awkward, stilted, like this guy who is a non-actor, obviously, probably a guy who actually manages a doll factory, going like, well, production quota's up, and if we're going to make our numbers, we have to, well, I just wanted to introduce Rose. She's going to be working here for us, and we just think she's really swell, and she's going to do a great job.
Yeah, a little flavor on Rose. Her previous job to the doll factory was she spray painted T-shirts at the mall. Mm-hmm. Those are hilarious.
She worked at the old folks' home.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Cleaning butts.
She did that too. She
that her own description. Yes. So the remainder of the film is a really quick pace, totally like lightly flavored detective story almost. Where an actual detective goes person to person that we know and interviews all of them and comes to the conclusion that Martha committed the crime.
What?
All right, let's do this.
You can't use any of that.
No, you can't. 3, 2, 1, bam! We both ended up very similar places. How nice.
I'd say if I had to assign a number to this, it would be about an 8. Oh. It was good. It was really good. Mm-hmm. Time, great. Doesn't need to be any longer. I was never bored, which was kind of surprising because everything was so normcore.
Mm-hmm.
2 thumbs up.
Yeah, very similar. I mean, I guess this one might be very brief as far as us, you know, showing our opinions about it. But yeah, it was very good. It was exactly the length that it should have been. Everyone felt engaging. I was very happy with it. And it's a unique movie.
Yeah, that about sums it up. There's no reason a movie like this should be good.
Yes.
Yeah. It has all the pitfalls of a low-budget film without falling into any of them.
Yeah, and I think it does that by making it all feel very honest. Mm. Like, you have all these non-actors delivering very real... Like, you made the Neil Breen comparison. And in a Neil Breen movie, you have a bunch of non-actors delivering dialogue, delivering unusual dialogue. But I think the difference is, in a Neil Breen movie, it's all written dialogue meant to sound like a real movie, and he can't pull it off.
You're not the same girl! I want that girl back.
She's not coming back.
Don't turn away. Let's talk.
Whereas in this movie, it almost sounds like he gave the actors a list of bullet points. Like, here's the ideas you should communicate in this scene, but didn't script anything.
Leave here, you only got so much time before I have to go to the other job, so.
It's about like the rest of us, I'm telling you.
Yeah, plus I gotta work nights, so if I wanna go out at night, I can't do that, unless I have a day off.
So. I'm ready for the beaches.
Yeah?
Yeah, I wanna go to Aruba.
Oh yeah?
I saw that on TV the other day, the beaches are great.
But what you get as a result is an incredibly original film that feels real. It feels like real people are in it. And it feels like a story you haven't heard before because these are the stories that aren't told. Stories about poor people in the middle of nowhere.
One of the things that this movie does is it makes you challenge your preconceptions of who these people are. And then with every one of the major characters, except maybe the detective, who is more of a plot device than a person, with every one of the other major characters, there's a moment where they say something or do something that makes you think, oh, there's a lot more to this person.
Mm-hmm.
You have a similar scene with Rose where she does the robbery and you realize, oh,
yeah.
This character that you had this image of where she was kind of, you already said the sense she was kind of harsh and a little bit disaffected. One of her first scenes has her saying, I hate this town, I can't wait to leave. Mm-hmm. And you kind of get that. She's a single mom also. Like, you have that kind of image of she's a single mom, small town, not a lot of money. Like, I would also be sort of grouchy about it. But you have, like, that's almost a sort of stock character in movies. And then she takes advantage of this guy she meets and robs this other very poor person of his only savings.
Yeah, and he was saving up. He was saving up for a car. She robbed him blind. She didn't just want the deed. She just wanted his money. That's so... Rose is a total B.
It's a messed up scene. But it makes you think, like, oh, this person that I thought was a stock character isn't.
And the biggest challenge of all would be that you can't believe that Martha would have murdered this person. But before the end came up, I started feeling like, well, you know, so far, every single person has subverted my expectations except for her. So she must be guilty.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm not evaluating them as real people. And at first you don't believe it, but then after the revelation comes that it was true, it makes sense now that this person felt so pigeonholed that it just came out like a crime of passion. And that was what actually happened.
Yeah, because she feels like Rose is kind of stealing her only friend away, the only other thing in her life, other than her depressing job and taking care of her ailing father.
Yeah, you know, I thought of it as it's more than just a friend, but it doesn't have to be, you know. Martha doesn't have to think of Kyle as, like,
when you
romantically.
Have, yeah.
It's her only friend.
When you have nothing,
yeah,
that kind of relationship can be the most important thing for you. and it probably was for her.
Mm. And she saw us slipping away, and she saw Rose. She's like the only person who saw Rose for what she was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Made me feel really sad for these characters and people.
And then the longer you get to know her, the pushier she gets, and the more favors she asks for. I mean, it was just one favor right after the other one.
I guess Steven Soderbergh planned on releasing more movies like this, but this one wasn't very well received.
Oh.
Really?
Yeah, it has it's like 60-something percent for Metacritic, Rotten Tomatoes and all that. Yeah, very, like, you could look at movies that have 60%, see this reel, and it's just going to go on and on and on and on and on, and it's just like crappo bullshit Hollywood films. And then right at the bottom right here, you got a little bit of, it's bubble.
Yeah.
And you're like, why? There's something unique here. There's something to be said. Isn't that worth something? But I guess at the same time, we're not saying it's one of the best movies ever.
No, but it's very, very good.
What's the shortfall here? Because I didn't want to give it 2 out of a score either, and I'm not really sure exactly why I feel that way.
I had a hard time swallowing the murder plot line.
Mm. Oh, is it the detective that bothered you?
There was so much focus on the detective. Like, it wasn't like there was an investigation going on and there was a detective involved. It was like suddenly the perspective character is the detective for a little while.
Blammo, here's the detective.
Like, I get why Martha would be upset. I have a hard time buying that she would just snap and strangle someone to death.
And that she doesn't even remember it herself. Martha leaves.
Mm-hmm.
We see her eating late night pizza alone, which is
what was the term that we coined for that, by the way?
I called it Ohio Nighthawks. I think that's a limiting factor. There's something that still feels off about a movie that is so hyper real for the first half becoming a murder investigation.
But that happens in reality, and these things have occurred. I think it's still believable. I don't know what really puts me away from saying that it's one of the greats. I guess the filmmaking, because it's so low budget and it's so naturalistic, it feels like it doesn't have much artistry to it. It just feels efficient. Like, the whole film is very efficient.
Mm.
But there's no, like, pretentiousness in there.
Yeah, I guess there's a limit to how much visual style you can have in a movie where you just use existing people's apartments and don't change anything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was describing this shoot when we were watching these movies to a friend of mine who I was working with, and I was trying to list off 3 films that we had just seen, and I was like, okay, well, we saw Madagascar. That's terrible. And then also, spoilers. And then we also saw this movie Bubble. It was very interesting, and it explained everything, and we went through it kind of like we did just now. And I was like, oh, yeah, what's... what was the other one? Who picked it? Man, Patrick had. What was it? It must have been really boring. I can't remember.
Capote is about...
Are you making a joke?
Is that on purpose?
Yes!
Okay, just making sure.
The M is, it's like reversed. The M is in silent, but the M is invisible in Capote.
Oh, really?
You know, like night.
Well, some people say...
The K is silent.
Right, but now
in Capote,
is invisible
in
Capote.
The critics loved this movie in 2005.
Yeah, they did, didn't they?
Standing ovation all around,
uh-huh.
Which is kind of lame. But Truman Capote is a famous author, I suppose.
Oh, yeah, he's famous. People know him.
Yeah, people know him.
Well, he's a big celebrity. I think that's why this movie was popular, because
you
got an actor who everybody already liked now doing the role that he's destined to play.
Oh.
And, well, I mean, he did a good job.
Yes.
This is the Philip Seymour Hoffman version of the Iron Lady.
I wouldn't go that far. I think there's more going on here, filmic-wise.
I think I agree, but it's a similar kind of effect.
Yeah.
We're like, oh, Meryl Streep in the role she was born to perform.
But at least be honest.
Who's honest?
I'm honest. I am honest about what I write about. I'll let you know if it's autobiographical, if it's about me, or if it's not. And I find autobiographical stories at this juncture in my life to be quite boring.
So there is a murder down in Kansas, right? A murder of a family of four. Mm-hmm. And Truman Capote reads about it in the New York Times. And it just like catches him. And he's like, I want to write about this. I want to go down there. So Truman Capote and Harper Lee, they talk to the people involved, you know, the friends or whoever the murderers, it may be. Well, eventually, I suppose this whole movie is about him eventually writing this book.
I think you like it. It's very masculine. It's in cold blood.
Isn't that good? And that refers to the crime or the fact that you're still talking to the criminals?
It's hard to remember anything because it all just feels like soup.
Yeah, it's kind of like soup. But Capote is a very charismatic guy. He's very charismatic. He's extremely manipulative, which
incredibly vain
for him. Yeah, so vain. Mm-hmm. It's like, okay, cool, you're gay in this time period when it's like, you know, cool, you talk funny.
Bergdorf's.
Sorry?
The scarf.
Oh, nice.
Thank you.
So when he eventually meets the murderers. Murderers. He ends up forming like a very emotional attachment to the murderer, the one who pulled the trigger.
Like after he meets the murderer, you can summarize the rest of the movie as like book happens almost.
Yeah.
Because there's not like the relationship.
Capote meets murderers. Book happens. And
yeah, because there's not really. There's a long stretch of the movie where nothing advances. It's just like a bunch of conversations between Truman Capote and this murderer. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't make any progress in the book for a while. And intercut with those conversations, there's other scenes of Capote being a drunk or hanging out with his boyfriend. Mm-hmm. Or like complaining to Harper Lee about something and Harper Lee like rolling her eyes at him. Mm-hmm. And nothing really happens at all.
Yeah, I don't know. It's like the movie is so well constructed, you feel like it should come away with a really great point, but I'm not certain exactly what the point is.
Maybe it's about sincerity in some way.
You think?
Because everyone is so insincere for much of the movie, mm-hmm. and by the end of the movie, you finally get the sense that Capote is like invested in something other than himself.
Yeah,
because he like really cares and writes this really great book. And seems to genuinely care about the fate of these two kids, and like at the end of but that just ends up making him like super depressive, and he drinks. Then he starts drinking way too heavily, and then then right before the credits, you get the little "This is a Hollywood movie" pop up that says, "Yeah, later Capote drank himself to death."
Yeah, which we all said that's not surprising at all.
He's an asshole.
Like he comes off as a bad guy who kind of deserves what he gets.
Let's show.
Three, two, one. Here's your shit.
Who wants to say why they rated it what they rated it?
I guess I did it the highest.
You've got the high score, dude.
Okay, here we go. Capote is a finely made film with a lot of great craft work and lead performance that is mesmerizing. It's probably one of the greatest performances of Philip Seymour Hoffman's career, and there's a lot about it that just speaks professionally made. And it's a story that will entertain you until it's over.
I don't know if I could disagree more strongly without like... There's only a difference of one point here. This is the strongest I could possibly disagree with you with that point difference. Uh-huh. This movie was f***ing boring. Like, it wasn't, like, this movie was not engaging whatsoever at all. I wanted it to end constantly.
Like, it was, well, you gave it a 6. What is that? You hated it?
My response is to this movie was, I guess I like this. Because it was very, very well done. There's a lot to admire about Capote. It's shot super well. The performances are really good. There's so much atmosphere, and it feels like there's like some thematic energy in the movie. But holy shit, was it boring. I was struggling to stay awake for the movie. There was nothing engaging about it to me. I feel like it was a good movie because there was a lot of great craft there, and there was something interesting being said. I just had a really hard time making myself listen.
I'm really surprised you thought it was so boring. I thought you would love this movie. And I'm also very surprised that I didn't think it was so boring.
When I say that it's engaging for most people, I mean like anyone of a particular demographic could watch this movie and be like, okay, yeah, that's good.
Except maybe young kids.
Well, but yeah. Look, we're not talking about young kids on this f***ing episode, okay? Okay, look, I have the higher score on this. I'm going to defend my position. The film is incredibly well made. Mm. Literally every technical aspect of it, including some of the emotional aspects of it, the performance aspect of it. Very well done. I'm thinking back to a scene between Perry Smith and Truman Capote where they're arguing inside of a cell. And originally I was looking at it and I thought, you know, this shot, because I'm familiar with shots being out of focus. This show looks out of focus. This is kind of amateurish. But then I realized, as the scene progressed, that the focal point kind of changed depending on who the focus of the conversation was. Like, who it was on. And you don't see that amount of thought in a lot of movies.
I don't know, I kind of resent it for the fact that I like it.
It sounds like you hate it a lot more than your 6, is what it sounds like to me.
This is a good movie that I don't like. I have a really hard time putting a number on it, honestly, because I don't like it so strongly, but it's also quite good. It's like the band Blur. Blur is an excellent.
Oh my god, I was about to say that.
Yeah, Blur is a terrific band that I will never listen to because I don't like it. Mm-hmm. Like, this was a good movie. I didn't enjoy it, and I won't see it again.
Alright, you f***ing piece of shit. Tell us about your goddamn f***ing piece of shit movie.
Alright, so my category was box office top 10.
F*** you.
For 2005, the top 10 box office movies were uninspired.
I hate you. I gotta watch War of the Worlds.
This is true.
My co-hosts are upset with me. Because of the kind of movie that I chose. And I maintain that I made the best possible choice.
You're worse than Hitler.
And the reason for that being that of all the movies that made a bunch of money,
ever see an enema and watching this movie
2005
forcefully,
none of them,
not by my own will, someone else's,
had as much of an impact on like culture and on movie making
on your brain
than Madagascar.
Tell us about Madagascar.
Madagascar is shit.
Diego? What could be worse than San Diego?
I don't know. This place is crack-a-lackin'.
So Madagascar, this group of animals in the Central Park Zoo, basically make a break for it.
Hold on, Patrick. You've skipped over so much plot information.
Who cares?
Alex, what are you doing?
I'm getting you out of the box. Relax.
Alex?
Giraffe! Corner pockets!
Wait!
Here goes
wait!
Nothing.
Wait! No, come on! Wait!
Hold still!
Hold
still!
No, come on!
Here I come!
Look!
This is the second time on the show that someone's dick was gonna get hit with a log. Blammoed.
Yeah! A very similar looking.
That's true. David Schwimmer's dick was gonna get blammoed.
They meet the lemurs. The lemurs have a king. The king is Sacha Baron Cohen doing a stupid voice.
Original King Julian, what a gentleman! I love all the girls, I love the move their body. When you move your body, you're gonna move it nice and sweet and sassy. All right?
And I learned that during production of the movie, this character, King Julian, was going to be like a tiny bit part. Mm-hmm. And then Sacha Baron Cohen showed up.
It says here that the part is outrageous.
Yeah, Sacha Baron Cohen auditioned for the role and improvised a lot of dialogue. And they said, "This is so funny, Sasha!" And put him in the movie. Mm-hmm. And it's intolerable.
He played King Julian, which I played in the RPG version of Madagascar with all of you here. Do not leave me with Julian. Patrick will be more. Okay. Hold on, I want to make sure they're rolling the shot here.
Pick an animal. I guess you do the short straw.
I like how they acknowledge in the thing that he doesn't want
to pick that in.
Oh, you have to be Julian. Okay.
That guy.
The lemurs like to dance and party, and that's where that song comes from. The one where people like to move it.
I like to move it. Which we can't sing, because our video will be taken down.
Yes. The lemurs are being terrorized by some predators.
Fusa.
The Fusa! The Fusa are attacking! It's a cookbook! It's a cookbook!
I thought Rob vanquished those Fusas.
Oh, he came close. He only got 7 out of 10.
Yeah.
Get him!
It's the part where I'm good. No, what are you doing? Yeah! F*** him up. You missed that one, Rob.
Oh, it's really sensitive.
There are times I laughed. I don't want my kids to see this, because it's insulting to children.
It might be morally reprehensible.
Yeah.
The lemurs hire the zoo animals because they're big. To scare off the Fusa, who are small.
Right.
And then the rest of the plot of the movie basically revolves around Alex the lion realizing he's a carnivore.
which, by the way, this is kind of horrifying, actually.
A little bit. Because he's starving to death on the island, and he doesn't know, he's only ever been fed steaks. He doesn't know what a steak is, just that it's what he eats. And he slowly realizes, oh, I eat other animals. How f***ed up is that? My best friend Marty is my prey.
It's a shooting star. Make a wish, quick. Ooh, how about a thick, juicy steak?
You know what, Alex? I promise you I'm gonna find you a steak tomorrow that kills me.
Thanks, Marty.
No, what have you done?
I promised you.
Oh, God.
Take it before I die. I need to see you eat it.
You know, there is a way you can harvest meat from animals and not kill them.
Why do you know this? Yeah, but don't worry, because he ends up eating fish, which are not sentient beings.
Oh yeah, fish are soulless, don't worry.
Yeah.
That's how this big emotional problem is resolved. Like, oh, it's fine, fish don't matter.
Yeah, they have all these talking animals and it's just like, oh yeah. But fish are whatever, basically.
Fish of no moral weight. Yeah, Madagascar is a movie about animals. It's a 3D animation movie from 2005, before 3D looked good. And so it all looks like a PlayStation game, as you said. It's not that bad. Madagascar, the thing is, it hardly needs an introduction. Yeah. Madagascar is that movie what's got the Move It song. You've heard it 100,000 times, and every time you hear it, you want to die. Alright, you ready, guys?
Ready.
3, 2, 1, review.
Patrick gave it a dollar sign.
Because they made dollar signs out of it.
I'm also going to go 3.
I gave it a 2 because it's a cinematic abortion.
You gave it a boo. I think my 3 might be the highest score.
I'm gonna say yes.
Yes.
First, I want to talk about the dollar sign.
Tell us about the dollar sign. Significance.
I mentioned before that this movie has no ambition.
You're incorrect. It has an ambition. movie a lot of money.
Exactly. The only thing this movie wanted to do was say, like, you know what? Kids are dumb, motherfuckers. I bet if we just put some animals on screen and had them talk at each other, they'd eat that shit up. What if we made one of them Sacha Baron Cohen and had him do a voice? That'd be funny. Mm-hmm. You know what else would be funny? A zebra who sounds like a black man!
Yeah. Black men are funny.
Yeah, kids love black people, they said to themselves. Especially Chris Rock. And this movie is precisely engineered to be a movie that sells DVDs because people's kids want to watch the movie 100 times.
Yeah.
And that's what Madagascar is about. And so grading it as art almost seems dishonest. But I think it does have a handful of jokes that are actually kind of funny. And while I was watching it, it wasn't boring. I didn't enjoy watching it, I don't think, but like, I was watching it.
I hated this movie. The reasons why are obvious. Naomi, what do you think about Madagascar?
It's terrible. It's terrible. There were times that were kind of funny.
Like what?
There are no parts that I can grab from there, but I laughed sometimes.
There are some parts that were funny. I can't think of what they are now.
There were moments in the movie that were funny. It was not completely devoid of value.
Yes. Yeah. The chameleon had great comedic timing. You guys didn't recognize who he was, but Rob played him.
Masakuro!
Masakuro.
Who picks a lizard as a token? Whatever, you're up.
Okay. What? Oh, oh shit. I skipped it.
He's like, hey there, everyone.
Is it for real, though?
Is this moose for real?
It's for real.
The moose.
I love moose.
He stole my credit cards. That's for real.
Hey there, everyone. It's showtime. This animal's got to watch out when it's looking for plants to eat in the water since it can't swim. Is this for real?
No f***ing way that's not real.
Moose are strong swimmers.
This is not for real. I can't speak to the rock's rope, but moose are actually strong
swimmers. This is not for real. See? That's one thing that we should bring up. I predicted this 2 times in a row. Oh, now they're gonna do this. And it was like, but wait, we haven't seen the other movie references that they're gonna pull because adults in the audience at this point will be bored. So we're waiting for that to happen. And they did it 2 times in a row with that.
Yep.
Damn you all to hell.
Darn you all to heck.
I would say if I were to agree with either of your scores, I'm going to go with Naomi.
Boo?
Boo. Yeah. Look, man. You gave Shrek 4 a 1.
Yep.
How is this 2 points better than Shrek 4?
Shrek 4 enraged me. While I was watching Shrek 4, I wanted to go full Virginia Tech on the movie.
Like, you can't say that.
He's kidding. Yeah, that's a joke.
Through the DVD, if none of them are on here.
It's a game.
Oh no.
Oh no.
Oh no, not this again.
Yeah. Like,
that was a movie that made me want to physically harm everyone involved with it and then myself.
How does this not bring you to the same point?
For whatever reason, that movie hit me personally. Like, that movie was like it felt like a personal f*** you to me.
Well, that's how this movie feels to me.
Yeah,
it feels like a personal insult.
I totally get it.
And you know what? The feeling is mutual.
It's a cynical cash grab that was so effective that it almost became a fundamental law of reality. Like, you can count on death, taxes, and Madagascar making money.